Welcome to InCast, Enjoy Health Education's podcast for dedicated healthcare professionals, educators, and administrators who are passionate about making a difference, encouraging healthy outcomes, and finding innovative ways to engage and empower new families and staff. Here's your host, Debbie Young. She's been a childbirth educator and doula for almost 30 years and came to Enjoy based on her love for educating families.
Today we'll be exploring the concepts of pain to pleasure during childbirth with Deborah Pascali-Bernaro. She's been featured on ABC's 2020 Good Morning Russia, the NBC Today Show, Discovery Health, in the New York Times, the LA Times, the UK Times, as well as a number of parenting and health magazines around the world. Deborah's a pioneer in reminding humanity that birth can be full of pleasure and delight. Deborah has trained thousands of doulas and birth professionals around the world in practices of gentle birth support. Deborah is the creator and director of Orgasmic Birth, a documentary that examines the intimate nature of birth, an everyday miracle. She sees the powerful role birth plays in women's lives when they're permitted to experience it fully. Deborah is a sought-after international speaker, the chairman of the International Mother-Baby Childbirth Organization, a member of the White Ribbon Alliance, a Lamaze International Childbirth Educator, a birth and postpartum doula trainer with Dona International, and the co-author of the book Orgasmic Birth, Your Guide to a Safe, Satisfying, and Pleasurable Birth Experience. Her newest baby, Pain to Power Childbirth, is an online childbirth class that will provide students with the keys to move from pain to pleasure in childbirth and beyond. Thanks so much for being with us today, Deborah.
Oh, thank you, Debbie. It's such a pleasure being here with you. And thank you for that introduction.
Yeah. There's so many ways that you've impacted birth and the maternity scene. And I just want to thank you for that. And I know we've known each other for a long time, and it's exciting to interview you for this podcast.
Yeah, it's so much fun, right? We've watched each other kind of grow as we've been both making kind of inroads into spreading a message of what's possible in childbirth so that everyone knows their options.
Right. And so many of our listeners are right there with us, wondering what they can do to help their own patients and students and clients really get more pain out of their birth and more pleasure into their birth. So could you just start by explaining the concept of working through pain to get to the pleasure?
Sure. And I love that question. I have to say that, you know, and I think many people that are listening, and you know this, that our culture right now, all we talk about is pain. We use a language for birth that's often illness-based, pain-driven. So often, even when we use the word contraction, when I'm in a group, right, and we say, when you think of contraction, what do you think of? I get more than half the people, the first thing they think of is pain. And so we know that mind-body connection, what the mind focuses on, the body feels. So I feel right now our culture is leading us to so much pain. And we could go through, and I encourage everyone to do that, go through all the language that we currently use about birth and about our bodies and pregnancy. And I ask each individual person that's pregnant to do that and find which are the words that make them feel healthy, strong, powerful, and which are the words, whatever phrase it is, that makes them feel that birth is illness or their body's not functioning, or worse, that it's a word that makes them think of pain. So for me, the first thing to acknowledge is that this idea that birth has to be filled with pain is something we're really putting out there that I don't believe it has to be to this extent. I work with literally thousands of people who, just from the simple thing of reframing language, a lot of times they'll tell me their labor was still hard or challenging, and they'll use other descriptors. But pain is not always their word of choice. So I think the beginning roots of it is to really examine what language you have and how can you change it to a language of power, a language of pleasure, of wholeness, of health, and wellness. But I like to go beyond that because I think then we have to go and say, well, where are your first stories coming from about birth? Because we were all born and we were all awake and conscious beings as our babies are when they're being born. And so learning, if it's possible, our own birth story, and if we still have the ability to have someone tell us it in intimate details, was pain, was difficulty imprinted in that experience? And the stories of our siblings, if we have them, of family members, because the stories we take in of children of birth, as we are children about birth, begin to frame for us how we feel. So you can change a language, but if your belief system is based on birth being terrible and horrible and the worst pain ever in your life, you still have to kind of examine that foundation and look at ways that we can change that. And sometimes I was blessed, it's what brought me into this work, that I heard lots of birth stories from my great-grandmother, my grandmother, and my mother, and no one used the word pain. Everyone talked with me about birth as kind of the work that you do as a woman, and that there would be challenges, but to move through it. They talked about being up and showering and walking and moving. My great-grandmother walking and working on the farm until she couldn't anymore, and how that was a great help in labor. And then being upright and leaning over the kitchen sink to birth her children and the midwife catching the baby. So I was really blessed that the word pain just never was in my vocabulary. When I became pregnant and I examined kind of those stories and beliefs that I had taken in, I was only filled with confidence and their words of joy and love and the great pleasure they had when the baby was born really stuck with me. So those would be my two kind of beginning places that are foundational, is our own, what I call her story, right? What is our kind of background in birth and what we've heard, and what's the language that we can change it to of health and wellness and pleasure. So is that a good starting place?
Yeah, that's a great starting place. And I think as you were telling your story, it reminds me of other activities we do as adults that may cause us a challenge and may even ultimately be somewhat painful if you think of it that way, but that where people are applauded and cheered on because they're working through that. And I think it would be wonderful if, like in a sporting event, when people are really challenged and really working hard, people are clapping. I would think it would be wonderful if we would do the same thing for women as we watch them work through an amazing process that does create challenge but ultimately gives pleasure. So that would be awesome.
I love that analogy because it's so true, right? And we don't look at our athletes and like cheer them on and think in our mind, oh my God, they're in such pain, let's cheer them on. We see it reframed because it's in health, it's in power. It's really what labor is, right? We're healthy, we're powerful. We associate pain usually with illness based, and it's usually something's wrong. And the sensations of labor are not wrong, they're right. And so how can we have a word for pain, right? That is, you know, if you're in a bad car accident and really get damage to your body, or, you know, you have severe kind of surgery, those are kind of pains, but we use kind of one word and expect to have all different variations. And I think that's been a disservice.
Yeah, and I think our culture limits us in that way too, where other cultures might describe it pain this way and pain that way, have different words. So, but you know, I was thinking too, my next question was about what we do in our culture to make birth seem only painful. And I know you answered that a little, but I remember a nurse early in my career saying, pushing out a baby is like pushing out a pumpkin. And that was such a dramatic and negative thought in my mind. It took me a few months to kind of reframe that and to think we probably should never be saying that to a mom. So,
right. Yeah. Our words are powerful, right? If we are the educator, the caregiver, the doula, I mean, our words really have lasting impact. So I'm sorry to hear that someone said that. That's so sad. But it does lead into that our culture, many people haven't seen a birth that's full of pleasure. And many of our practices, and I always want to honor that, you know, we created a lot of practices and moved birth from home to hospital, and we've benefited. There are some people that their lives are saved based on cesareans and technology, and everything has a time and place. But our overuse and just focusing so heavily on the technology and literally putting women, thinking it was safer, into beds, and putting, stripping their identity, as Robbie Davis Floyd, a great medical anthropologist, would say, by putting on gowns and plugging them into the system with IVs, has had a cost that we've actually made labor and birth more difficult. And that's where I would say painful. I think a lot of the pain sometimes is created by a system that was developed to know everything they could at every moment to be ready to help, rather than asking the question, what can we do not to disturb the process? What can we do to remember my great-grandmother's comfort measures and the women and these techniques that were handed down through the years and that doulas are returning to birth? We're kind of flipping it to the other side. So we have to first really re-examine and know that our doctors and nurses and midwives are amazing. And it's no disrespect to them, because I really value all of them. But many of them have been educated into what I call a dysfunctional system. And luckily now it feels like we're at that tipping point where science is really showing us kind of what great grandmother's wisdom was, is validated. And we're re-educating everyone in a way of how can we have the technology and the interventions available for the few that really need it, but really help the others to literally move and dance. And as you know, there are just so many more joyful and pleasurable things that we can do in preparation and in labor and birth that truly can transform it and open us up to so many more possibilities.
Oh, definitely. And I love your term, understand undisturbed birth. And, yes, you know, I think that ACOG just came out with some guidelines to say maybe we shouldn't be doing all these things. Maybe we should be backing off, which is heartening to us who believe that too. And so can you think of some really tangible things that hospitals can implement in their policies to foster kind of that undisturbed birth where the caregivers are the lifeguard, so to speak, rather than swimming next to the swimmer?
Yes. And I love that analogy too, because so often I do say they should be the lifeguard. And the problem is we've got all the lifeguards in the pool, right? And what would that be like for us on our back? You know, we're trying to swim with a lifeguard on our back. They're not saving us. They're actually making it more difficult. But I think they're really simple things. And, you know, I love Sarah Buckley, Dr. Sarah Buckley from Australia, and with Childbirth Connection, their hormonal physiology report, she outlines so well the three elements that everyone needs for their hormones to work optimally. And when their hormones are flowing, they're going to feel less pain and also find more pleasure. And that's to feel private, safe, and unobserved. And I wish that those three criteria for every nurse, doctor, midwife, administrator, doula, anyone would really say that that should be the initial checklist. Like, those would be the things I would want to know at a prenatal visit and really say, what does safety look and feel like to you? What does privacy look like? And, you know, let's talk about being unobserved. And right away, sometimes when we think of unobserved, we think, well, don't have 20 people in the room. Well, that's certainly true. And that's a good starting point, is to really minimize the number of people that really need to come and go in a birthing environment. But fetal monitors are an observer. If you sit there and you're looking at the machine and listening, that's observing you maybe even more than someone coming in and out. And we as women sometimes are bad. We can be our own observer. We can be thinking, you know, how do I look? Am I doing it right? What about the sound I'm making? What are they thinking? And so I just want to broaden that it's really individual for each person on defining safety, privacy, and being unobserved. But if we understood each person's unique definition and what they need for that, then we could do subtle things from in a teaching hospital, make sure we're honoring and limiting the number of essential people that have to come in and out, even in a community hospital, dimming lights, smell. We talk about that so much, right? I love to say to people, and this is my kind of prenatal question, is that birth is a part of our sexuality. And the same circumstances that we need to open to intimacy are the same circumstances we need to open to birth. The exact same hormones of orgasm have to flow in the exact same sequence in childbirth. And whatever would disturb them in an intimate moment, and that's whether we're alone and getting our own moment of pleasure and intimacy, or if we have a partner, we all know that for most of us, if the door opened and we were in the middle of an intimate act and a stranger walked in, most of us would lose that loving feeling. If someone came in and asked us three questions and we had to answer them, I think most of us would lose that intimate loving feeling. So if we really began to honor that birth is a part of our sexuality, then as caregivers, we must really say, would you do whatever, X, Y, and Z, if people were in the middle of a sexual act? What would you do if you had to come in? Would you come in quieter? Would you knock and ask permission to come in? I mean, the simple thing about giving people the ability to say, come in now or wait, that's huge, right?
Right.
Someone can knock at a door, and why don't we do that in a hospital? Like, I still haven't gotten over why we created this thing that you're in the most intimate, vulnerable moment, often naked or with barely anything on, and nobody has to knock, and they don't even have to introduce themselves. Like, to me, that's crazy.
Luckily, I've been with parents many times where they are treated with that respect, but yeah, I think we need to make sure that's happening. And I don't think caregivers necessarily say, I'm going to be rude to people today. It's just that that is their job, and they're not necessarily conscious on every moment of how that negatively impacts what's going on, right?
Right. No, it's true. Like, we've been indoctrinated into a system that didn't have that awareness. And it's good to hear that you're seeing a shift. I'm seeing a shift sometimes, but not all the time. And I wish it was just a universal given that we brought more respect to the sacredness of birth and to each person in that sacred act of laboring and giving birth.
Yeah, I agree with you. I hope participants of this podcast will share it with people who probably need to hear this, because, you know, it may not even be in the front of their mind about this respect that we can give people in this most intimate and vulnerable act. So I was going to ask this question later, but I might as well ask it now. Why did you choose the name orgasmic birth? And now that you're talking about birth as part of our sexuality, maybe I know.
Totally, but it's really an interesting journey, so I'm glad you're going to let me share this story. I've often talked about birth as a part of our sexuality. I really learned a lot of this from great midwives, Ina Mae Gaskin, Elizabeth Davis, who really were bold and talked about orgasmic birth and even women having birthgasms. And I like to separate out that orgasmic birth, the word orgasmic is really heightened physical and emotional sensation. So like, I have orgasmic moments every day because I have dark chocolate, and that's orgasmic to me. And I love to dance like just wildly in the middle of working. I take a 3-minute break and just go crazy. And that's like orgasmic release. So orgasmic is a broad sense of bringing joy, pleasure, ecstasy, and love to yourself and to birth. So orgasmic birth in those terms to me always had the broadness. And yet I honored that there were this small percentage of people that were having birthgasms, literally big orgasms, at some point in labor and or even in the moments of birth. So I was getting very mad at television as we started having these shows that were showing birth and, you know, the music. I used to equate it to Jaws sometimes. Like, if you look at the background music, they kind of gave you this scary buildup and then edited it in a way of everything that could go wrong. And they weren't telling all the things that could go right, and they weren't showing the beauty and the sacredness. So here I am yelling at the screen, and meanwhile I'm teaching workshops about sexuality and pleasure and using the term orgasmic birth. And I literally woke up in the middle of the night with this idea, like I saw in a dream, to make this documentary. But I didn't have a name for it, and I wasn't so bold at that moment to say orgasmic birth. My working title, and you're going to laugh, and everyone listening is going to laugh, was An Ordinary Miracle: Global Models of Care.
Yes, and less eye catcher, yeah.
Yeah, totally boring, right? Like that film would have been made and sat in a desk drawer somewhere, and it would still be hiding in a drawer. But I started making that film, I thought, but doing it from my speaking persona of pleasure and love and sexuality, but with this very safe title, right? So it wasn't that what we were filming and the name were not in sync, but I was trying to be safe, right? Like it's bold to kind of step out. So I got invited to HBO Showtime. I lived outside New York City, I should say that. I joined a filmmaker club because when you have a dream in the middle of the night to make a film, but you have no skills, you have to start learning how to make a film. So I started in some film classes, Matt, and I got what, like, for me was like the Willy Wonka golden ticket. I applied to get in this, what they called a pitch session, and 300 people got a ticket to come in and have 5 to 10 minutes to share your ideas about your film project and get critique from the heads of HBO and Showtime and a few other networks. Well, the day that I was going to it, I was teaching a workshop about comfort and pleasure and talked about orgasmic birth. And as I was ready to leave, because I had to leave quickly to get to this evening event, one of the women there, a new doula, said to me, "What else are you doing?" And I said, "Well, I got to run. I'm like, got this pitch session. I'm going to make a film." And she said, "I'm a filmmaker." And she was like, "Where are you going?" And I explained, and she said, "Do you want like a film doula? Can I come with you?" And I happened to have an extra ticket. And I said, "I'd love a film doula. I'm really nervous. I'd love a doula at this event." So she came with me. And when my turn came and I got to stand up and say, "An Ordinary Miracle, Global Models of Care," because the first thing you did was your name and your title. And then you went on to have your 5 minutes to explain. All I got was the title out. And the head of HBO said, "You can sit down. With a title like that, we don't need to hear anymore. Who would be interested?" And I almost, like, it was like someone punched me in the stomach because I was already making this film and I was so excited about it. And so I like just thought, okay, I'm going to yell out a second name. And I wasn't quite bold enough. And I yelled, "Ecstatic birth." And he said again, "You're obviously a new filmmaker. Like, who cares? Sit down." And as I started to sit down, my film doula hit me and said, "You talked all day about orgasmic birth. That's your title. Yell it out." And for a second, it was like, "No." And she's like, "What do you have to lose?" So I stood back up and yelled out orgasmic birth. And the entire audience laughed. And at that point, I didn't know if they're laughing at me or with me. And it didn't really matter because the head of HBO said to me, "Now, is that possible?" And they gave me 10 minutes to talk about the sensuality, sexuality, sacredness, and pleasure in birth. And when it was done, they said, "You make that film, you're going to change a paradigm. That's a message that needs to get out." And the funniest part was I kind of left, and I'm forever grateful to my film doula because she gave me the boldness, as doulas do. We need that person, that doula in life, right? That helps us step into our power to really be bold. But she allowed me to speak what I had been speaking all along, but somehow wasn't naming the film. And I walked out and called my husband and said, "Honey, guess what? I have a new name for my film." And he said, "What is it?" And I said, "Orgasmic birth." And there was silence on the other end. And after a few seconds, he said, "Now, Deborah, are you really ready to be that bold?" And I said, "Yes, I am." And he said, "Then do it."
Excellent.
And that's how orgasmic birth kind of was born and went from really what I was already at, but I needed to take that bold step. And I encourage everyone, you know, the definition of insanity, someone told me later, is to kind of do the same thing and expect different results. And I think that right now in childbirth, we need to be bold with shifting the language and shifting the opportunities.
Well, and I totally agree with you. And I know we've been mostly talking to healthcare providers now, but I'd like to talk just for a minute to the educators and doulas too. How can the educators help women find the power that you've just described in birth? What can the educators do prenatally to help, and then the doulas during the birth itself?
Great question. Well, one, I think that we birth the way we live. And so one of the first things we need to do as educators and as doulas too at prenatal visits is to really give people opportunities to look at what have been their powerful moments, what have been their challenges, what ways have they worked with their challenges in the past. And I say to everybody, like, you need to start taking lists, and I want at least 3 times every day that you find moments of pleasure. And going through a challenging time is not an excuse. That's even more reasons to shift your hormones if you're in a stressful life situation, life event, and we all have them. I mean, life gives us those joys and those challenges just as a part of living. How are you going to shift that in any given day? And so I think as educators, we have to spend a little bit more time on letting people go into their own kind of closet of what are their challenges and what are their ways to manage them and what are their pleasures, so that they can create their personal pleasure kit. I also think that as educators, we often focus so much on how to manage the actual sensation, or I like to call them surges, your own personal power surge. And we don't spend as much time in the time between. And so a lot of people who are saying, well, I can't imagine in the intensity of that surge, kind of kissing or doing something that brings pleasure or dancing wildly. And some people can. A lot of people do it during the surge, more intimate things. But you can use those times in between. So I have everyone create 5 things that they enjoy, from songs they like to sing, music they love that they can dance wildly to, and even if it's in between a surge, they do it then, and really develop that kind of fun, joyful pleasure kit. I also ask everyone to have 5 things on YouTube that make you laugh like you're gonna wet your pants. And YouTube is just such a blessing, whether it's crazy funny animals or laughing babies or skits or whatever. But on any given day, pull up a 1 to 2 minute YouTube and just laugh where tears are rolling down your face. And whether you were stressed before or nervous or sad or happy, or if you're in labor and you're afraid or you just felt a lot of pain, 1 minute of laughter will totally shift your hormones and you'll be ready for the next surge with a different mindset. So what I'm saying in all of this is I feel as educators and as doulas, we need to find more tips and tools that can switch the energy quickly, because we're going to all in life have moments of challenge. In labor, we may have moments of challenge. We don't know what labor will ask of us, but I think we could have a broader kind of toolkit that honors the challenge but can move it in new ways.
That is so grateful. I mean, I'm so grateful for that, because now I'm going to pull up YouTube videos of little goats dancing in their pajamas. That's my favorite. So yeah, definitely my favorite. So I'll use that in my class as an example from now on.
Isn't that great? Now you have me. I'm going to look that one up to see it. I haven't seen that one yet.
Oh, it's the most fun. And I don't know what it is about baby goats, but it's the most fun. So when we're teaching in classes, or when a healthcare professional is talking to the patient, a lot of discussion comes around informed decision. And, mm-hmm. you know, thinking about informed decision and what role it plays in the hospital setting, is there anything we should be keeping in mind to make more pleasurable activities happen? Are there things that we're doing that moms are just saying yes to that may negatively impact the ability to have a pleasurable birth?
Yeah, and I would say, and I ride both sides of this, I think even trying to make a lot of decisions in labor is impeding pleasure, because, again, bringing it back to your own intimacy, if in the middle of being intimate, someone said, you know, you have to choose between A and B, and like, here are the three things that you should think about. I mean, we all can just for a second go, well, how would that work for keeping that intimate feeling going?
Yes, for sure.
So, yeah. So, I mean, there is this thing, and yet I agree with you. I think that every person needs to be really respected and honored, and this is your birth, a day that you'll never forget. And so you want to be part of decision making to honor that. But I would back in and say, especially if you're low risk, a healthy birth, so the odds that you're going to need a lot of interventions is relatively low, really going over your choices ahead of time, really doing as much informed decision making and discussion with your caregivers and your entire team prior. As chair of the International Mother Baby Childbirth Organization, I get to see a lot of facilities and places around the world that are working to improve care. And one of our demo sites is in Austria, and they don't believe that labor is a decision making time legally. And so they, one, have people sign the consent that when you admit to a hospital long before, that you can't sign it when you're in labor. And I think that's wise, because how many people in labor have ever read that document?
Right. Yeah.
Like, that's crazy. And yet you're signing your name. I mean, on any other given day, if you walked in a car dealer and they said, sorry, we don't want you to read this, just sign, we'd all say, are you kidding me? And yet we're putting you in a position for your body and your baby that you're signing a blanket form that you don't even know what it says. So that's done ahead. And the other thing they do is they go over every technique, treatment, and intervention ahead of time. They really make sure that everybody has the knowledge. They use the best evidence, the Cochrane database, to really show benefits and harms of different procedures. And then the families, the parents, the mothers, sign. So in other words, if you wanted an epidural in labor, you can't consent in labor. You have to attend the class in pregnancy on comfort. But what's important to know in that class, not only is an epidural talked about in the procedure and how it's done and the benefits and the potential side effects and harms, but they let you know that that's really a second line comfort measure, that frontline comfort is moving and balls and upright and water. In every room, they have aromatherapy, dimmers, places to hook up music, and they talk about music and lights and privacy as part of comfort. They also, all their midwives are trained in both acupuncture and homeopathy, so that those are also used as frontline in comfort. And if labor gets challenging and we need to do anything, the rooms have ladders and ropes and open space. The bed is not the center of the room. The bed is off to the corner. The center of the room is open free space where you can put a nice thick foamy pad down that's actually big enough for you and your partner and your doula and your midwife to all get on it. So this class on really making sure you're informed about an epidural is really making sure you're informed about the full range of comfort, and then they're providing it. And this way, when you're in labor, you've already been given the information so that if you do decide you want the epidural, we don't need to have a full discussion at that point, because it's clear that you signed the release when you were in a clear state. You had all the time to ask questions, understand it, come back to your next visit with more questions and that. And now when you want it in labor, we move to it. So although there's still some decision making for other techniques and interventions in labor, and I just used an epidural as one example, they're protecting more your brain. And I think we have to find ways to honor informed decision making, but also protect our brains, because our brains are releasing the hormonal flow. And the more we disturb that thinking, the more we might be getting informed decision, but are we disturbing labor even more? So it's an interesting look in on how can we provide the best respectful care, and how can we at the same time keep labor flowing and moving and gently opening.
Yeah.
So I'd love for every person to consider that more, and what discussion is really essential and what we could be moving in to prenatal care.
Yeah, and I think that the list of things that you just mentioned are not something that anybody's going to start tomorrow, just make a change overnight. But I bet that every single person listening to the podcast today said, well, we could do that at our facility, or I could offer that when I'm working with a mom. So I really encourage people to look at the list and, take those baby steps to move to the place where moms are in a situation where they can not be dwelling on pain, but be thinking about all of these other things you just mentioned is so great.
Yeah, it's so amazing when you walk in the room in Austria. So such a different feel. And we all know that you can walk into a space and immediately go, oh, this feels so nice and luscious and whatever. I mean, even use restaurants. You can walk in a place and it has one feel, and then you walk in a fast food and they've chosen colors and a feel purposely not to get you to settle in and get comfortable. They've used design consciously to either have you move through quicker or stay longer. And I think we haven't really thought about the effects of our birth environment in the same way. And a lot, as you say, of one step at a time, right? Each step makes a difference on
Right.
what we could do in changing the environment. And ultimately, whenever, and I know there are people listening that might be in the process soon going to redesign their labor and delivery, I think we need to be looking at the facilities that just their redesign is lowering interventions and getting more positive, pleasurable births, and really doing that evaluation before we rebuild.
Right. Yeah, and that's an exciting idea that, you can redesign your unit to, make a difference, and that's really a great idea. I'm so thankful for people like you who are out there really bringing that discussion up and saying things can change and change positively and be safe, and those two things are not mutually exclusive. And so I would like to just kind of wrap up today with the main thing you would like our listeners to take away from our discussion and, the things that they can do to positively impact what's going on in their own organizations.
Yeah, and I would say for each person listening to just take a moment and say a couple questions. If you've already thought of as birth as a part of a woman's sexuality, what have you already implemented to honor that? And if this concept is new and you're struggling with putting those kind of thoughts together, ask yourself why. And see if you can identify, because I think we have barriers to opening up to the intimacy of birth. It's not something we often talk about. So we need to look at our own personal barriers to it. And then my last one would be whether it's easy or whether it's difficult, but if you could give yourself a few moments, really sit down in a quiet place and really come from a place that birth is intimate, sacred, and a part of sexuality. If it was you giving birth and you honored it as an intimate sexual act, what would you need to feel safe, private, and unobserved? And I think we have to start from ourselves and really say, if we look at birth in this new lens, let's make it personal first. What do we need? And is there one or two things you would need? Turn the lights down, do simple things that you could start out at birth tonight, when you go to your next birth that you're attending. And then to start having these kind of discussions with people giving birth in pregnancy, can you be comfortable to open up this dialogue and begin to listen? What would people need? And often, this is not about money, We spend a lot of money on birth, but I think we're overspending and under-delivering. Most of these things are really very gentle, simple little tweaks that we can do, but they make a world of difference. So I think it starts with us, each one of us, and then being really willing to lead the discussion and listen to how others would answer these same questions.
Well, thank you so much for those thoughts and for being with us today. And I hope that people get a lot out of this podcast. And if they want to look up you online, where would they go to find you?
Well, two places, and one they'll remember in a heartbeat, orgasmicbirth.com. And if you haven't seen our film, it's streaming there, so you can take a quick peek and rent it or use it in your classes. A lot of educators use clips of it. Or paintopowerchildbirth.com, which really is a class full of secrets that we just started kind of the peeking at on how to move a birth from pain to power with pleasure. So I'd love to hear from people, and I really do wish you a pleasurable journey with these thoughts and ideas. And thank you so much, Debbie, for inviting me to join you today.
Okay, thanks so much, Deborah. We'll talk to you again soon.
This episode of InCast is complete. Tune in regularly to hear more insightful conversations. And be sure to visit enjoyhealtheducation.com to see how Enjoy can help you inspire families and staff through our diverse childbirth and parenting teaching solutions. Or call us at 1-800-326-2082.